Dr. Ila Gupta from Gurgaon to speak on the role of albumin in OHS assessment.
Now, my topic is role of albumin in ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome. Now, why there is so much of stress on ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome and why everyone is so afraid of the patients going into ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome? Maybe is this because iatrogenic condition and it's result into life-threatening complications of controlled ovarian stimulation, especially in IVF cycles. Now, earlier, the incidence of ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome used to be 23.2%. It was reported by Golin et al. In 1989. And now, if we see the incidence of ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome as reported in ESHRAE, it's now 1.2% of all the stimulated cycles. So it has reduced drastically. Now, sometimes there is a reporting is not proper or the incidence may vary from clinic to clinic. So whatever the difference in incidence or difference in reporting, the range has been reported to be 0.1 to 2% all over. Now, why it's considered to be more serious and detrimental? Because of the marked extravascular exudate, profound intravascular depletion, it results into hemoconcentration and increased blood coagulability. Now, as this may lead to potential fatal outcome, the syndrome remains a serious problem for specialists dealing with infertility and leads to two important clinical questions. One is it possible to identify the patient at risk and which preventive method should be applied when an exaggerated ovarian response occurs? Now, if we look at the preventive strategies, the first most important thing is the identification of patient at risk. Now, patient of polycystic ovaries coming to us, the day one, we start counseling that group of the patient that if we start stimulation even for IUI with the gonadotropin, there are chances of going into hyperstimulation syndrome and what precautions they have to take and what all we can do to prevent this condition. The second is when the patient coming to us to decide for the protocol, which protocol we have to choose for that patient. The antagonist protocol reduces the incidence and to start with low dose stimulation. Then gonadotropin releasing hormone agonist trigger instead of giving SCG trigger, cancelling the cycle which is now the incidence is reduced in today's era, then coasting or the ovarian follicular aspiration, then administration of glucocorticoids and progesterone in few studies have reported to reduce the incidence. Now more commonly used are IV albumin or hydroxyethyl starch. Use of cabergolin is also has a good result. And the lastly is the cryopreservation of all the embryos and then take the patient for frozen embryo transfer cycle. Now there are many therapeutic options to suggest, ameliorate and reduce the risk of ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome. So beside adopting all these preventive steps, most commonly used methods are either the human albumin or hydroxyethyl starch. Now, how do the albumin help? As albumin has both osmotic and the transport function, it maintains the intravascular volume and plays a major role in ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome by binding and inactivating the vasoactive intermediates which are responsible for the pathogenesis. And if we administer 50 grams of human albumin, it will draw more than 800 ml of extracellular fluid into the circulation within 15 minutes. The safety and efficacy of albumin has a record of proven efficacy and safety. It rarely causes adverse effect, but still the incidence of urticaria, fever, chills and hypotension ranges in between 0.47 to 1.53%. It is convenient to use as no cross-matching is required, but definitely the cost factor is there. It's costly. Albumin, as it's a human product, so transmission of infection by blood-borne viruses can never be entirely excluded. On the other hand, there's a hydroxyl ethyl starch, which is an alternative to albumin with comparable physical properties, able to avoid severe OHSs or at least blunt the severity of hyperstimulation. It also increases oncotic pressure. And 500 to 1000 ml of hydroxyethyl starch is given at the time of ovum pickup and if required then at the time of embryo transfer also. It's considered to be cheaper as compared to albumin and safer. Because of its synthetic origin, the risk of viral transmission is rare or not possible at all. Now in 1993, Esch et al. Proposed the use of IV administration of human albumin during and after oocyte retrieval as a safe, effective and economical treatment for prevention of severe OHSs. Now, since then, there are many supportive and the negative theories for albumin administration. So, if we could look at the record, these are the supportive and the negative theories. So, now the question is, what should we prefer, albumin or hydroxyethyl starch? So, aim of this study was, as there are severe contradictory reviews regarding the role of albumin in preventing OHSS, and there are very few studies comparing the efficacy of albumin and HAES. So, study was conducted in a hospital to see, to compare the efficacy of albumin and hydroxyethyl starch. So, it's a retrospective study from February 2011 to 2013. Now, in this study, we made two groups. Group of 43 patients receiving human albumin, about 50 ml, 25% of albumin, and another group of 43 patients receiving 500 ml of 6% hydroxyethyl starch. And the age group of patients were similar, 25 to 32 years in both the age groups, with the BMI of 20 to 22%, and they all underwent ICSI cycles with high risk of developing OHSS. Now, on the day of SCG, the E2 levels were more than 3,000 picogram per ml in both the groups, and the number of follicles more than 15. On ultrasound, there were presence of free fluid around the ovaries and in the pelvis, and the ovarian size was more than 7 centimeter. So, prophylactically, albumin and HAES was administered on the day of pickup and embryo transfer, and these patients were followed till day 7 of embryo transfer to check for the severity. So, we observed that no severe VHSS case was seen in albumin in both the groups, while two patients from albumin group and one patient from HAS group went into moderate ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome. But the pregnancy rate was similar in both the groups. Now, if we see at the literature in human reproduction 1997, there's a reduced incidence of hyperstimulation by prophylactic infusion of hydroxyethyl starch, and they reported it to be an effective and economic alternative to albumin. Another study in 2002, this was done by Gokman in 2001, it's a randomized study to compare the efficacy of albumin and HAES, and he also observed no severe OHSS in both the groups, and he recommends preventing OHSS by using HAES because it is efficient, as efficient as albumin, but safer and cheaper than human albumin. Again, there are several reviews as reported by Abbas Aflatunian in 2005 do not suggest a role of prophylactic IV albumin in severe OHSS. Now, there's a study in 2011, it's a Cochrane database review. The author's conclusion is there's a limited evidence of benefit from intravenous albumin administration at the time of oocyte retrieval in the prevention or reduction of the incidence of severe OHSS in high-risk group of patients, and hydroxyethyl starch markedly decreases the incidence of severe OHSS. And there was no evidence of statistical difference in the pregnancy rate in both the groups of treatment. So to conclude, severe OHSS could not be prevented in absolute term, whatever we give albumin or historal, they can only reduce the severity of OHSS in the treated patients. And HAES has a shorter half-life and high molecular weight. Still, it shows a comparable result in minimizing the severity of OHSS in patients at high risk. Now, HAES is recommended for preventing OHSS since it is as efficient, safer, and cheaper than human albumin. Now, the only point which goes in favor of albumin or albumin is recommended in those cases where there is drop in the level of albumin or following aspiration of large volume of albumin-rich ascitic fluid. Albumin and HAS may be feasible means of secondary prevention, ameliorating, but they do not eliminate the physiological operation of the disease. So if we are careful since beginning, identify the patient who are at high risk, counseling this group of patient and selecting the protocol for them, starting with low dose of stimulation, if we are careful since beginning, then we can reduce the incidence of ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome to a significant extent. So with this, I thanks to all of you for being patient.